So welcome if you're visiting us on YouTube. Lovely to see you. Well, we can't see you, but lovely that you can see us and join in with us. And I hope you can really enjoy the service today. And that we all sense God's presence together, that we hear his word and receive what he wants to say to us, and enjoy worshiping together as part of our community, even if we can't be together. So going to hand over to Lorna, who's going to lead us in some songs of worship.
Unmute your microphone. I'm unmuted now. Yeah, okay. Right, we're gonna start by singing good old one, like Water You Turned Into Wine, just to focus us and really get us focused on God and who he is. After the second song, I just wanted to give you a sort of up warning up ahead. You've got chance there to share on chat some of your own praises, so anything that you feel really like great about that God has done in your life, any praise just for who he is, anything at all that comes into your heart, into your mind, just feel free to put it on the chat there. And at the end of the second song, Ian will be able to sort of read some of those out, maybe pray them out. We'll see how we go. Okay, so here we go. You shine out of the ashes, we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. 'Cause our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Darkness, you shine. Out of the ashes, we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. 'Cause our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. Our God is greater. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. Our God. And if our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? God is with us, what could stand against? If our God is for us, who could ever stop us? If our God is with us, what could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, what could stand against? If our God is for us, who could ever stop us? If our God is with us, what could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is higher. He is stronger. He is higher than anybody. From our heads into our hearts. We know it's truth, but sometimes we struggle to live in the reality of that truth. He is greater, he is stronger, he is higher than any other. Who you are and what you've done in Christ and who we are in Christ. We long for you, Lord. We invite you here this morning. We invite you to cleanse us, to wash us, to strengthen us. You alone have saved. Rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. Sing that again. Praise is rising. welcome you here, Lord. Jesus, we welcome you here. May I just encourage you to write your praises out. Share them with each of us so we can be encouraged by your praises. The Lord inhabits the praises of his people.
Some of the comments in the chat, we have Anne says, thank you, Lord, that your grace is unending and we give you praise. Emmanuel and Jumi, Yahweh, the awesome wonder who is always by our side. God is greater, stronger, higher than all of our troubles and trials. He cares for us. Corinne just puts the quote, Isaiah 58 verse 11, which says this, and the Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your desire in scorched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a well-watered garden, like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. Val says, thank you, Father, for your great faithfulness. Jill says, thank you, Jesus, that you chose the cross. You went there of your own choice. Andrea, thank you, Lord, for your mercy. Your grace knows no bounds. We are saved through your Son. Yes, Lord, we echo those prayers and we thank you that you welcome us into your presence, that your presence has been with us in everything we've done this week, whether we've been at work, whether we've been at home, whether we've been socializing a little bit more than we might have been, whether we've been out in the open air or isolated on our own, we know that you've been with us and you always are with us. But Lord, also when we meet like this together, we want to say to you that you are welcome, that we desire to meet with you, Lord. We don't just want to sing songs. We don't just want to read words and read the Bible. We want to meet with you. That's the goal, that we would meet with you. And we thank you that that's your desire as well, that you are for us and that you love meeting with your people. So we honor you this morning, Lord, and we ask, Holy Spirit, come, Holy Spirit. The ancient prayer of the church, come, Holy Spirit. Show us who you are. Show us Jesus, who died for us. Show us the Father who created all this and sustains us. Open our hearts and our minds to your word that teaches us, encourages us, trains us in righteousness, and corrects us when we go wrong. And come by your Spirit, Lord, we pray. May each person know they've met with you today, from the youngest to the oldest. In the name of Jesus. Amen. A couple more prayers, actually, just before we finish. We've got Claire. Ephesians 2 says that God is rich in mercy. It's the only time in the Bible where we read that God is rich in anything. Mercy comes naturally to him and is everything he is. And Patricia as well. Thank you, God, for guiding me through this week with all its, I presume, something like trials or troubles and difficulties. Well, thank you, Lorna. That was great. Thank you very much for leading us. And so if you've been with us in our church for or online for the last few months, you know that we've been looking at the book of Acts. It's Luke, Dr. Luke's story is the same Luke that wrote the Gospel of Luke, writes his second gospel, really, the things that happen after Jesus rose from the dead and then ascended to heaven, and what happened in his wake after the Spirit is sent. So he's writing to the first Christians. Let's get onto the PowerPoint slide. And so the gospel, the good news of Jesus, that Jesus is Lord, the long-awaited Messiah that's been for thousands of years in the waiting, has happened. And the gospel, this good news, is breaking new ground. And last couple of weeks we've met, we've seen how it's broken ground through somebody called Philip, who wasn't one of the apostles, wasn't one of the original disciples, but was comes onto the scene. And we saw that how the gospel spreads to a region where Jews and Sumerians didn't really get on with Jews, and Jews didn't really get on with Samaria. They didn't see things the same way, even though the Sumerians had a faith of their own. And actually, we see this amazing, couple of weeks ago, we saw how an amazing revival took place, how Samaria accepted the word of God. And as we sung this morning, the same Jesus that turned water into wine, that healed the sick and the broken, was doing it through people like Philip. And he said that, didn't he, to his apostles, to his disciples, you're going to do greater things than I did in my name. And that's, we're seeing it fulfilled. Last week, we saw how the gospel spreads even further. This time, down south, Philip's told by the Spirit, isn't he? He hears the Spirit's call to go down south. He doesn't know what he's going to do, and he doesn't know who's going to meet there, but he does. He meets an Ethiopian eunuch, and he shares the good news of Jesus, starting with the prophet of Isaiah. And then, as in church history, we believe that that was the start of the gospel actually taking root in Africa. So the gospel is spreading, and actually, in spite of enemies, the persecution only accelerates the mission, interestingly, isn't it? So we've got this, we've met Saul, haven't we, a few weeks ago. And Saul's the one who's this Pharisee, this religious zealot, really, this absolute fundamental religious zealot, but an aggressive one, who sees that what these guys are doing is blasphemous. They're actually preaching about Jesus being the long-awaited Messiah. Well, that's blasphemy. And so he thinks he's doing God's work by trying to stamp it all out. And he makes it his mission, his life mission, to go and stamp out this new movement. And actually, today's story is set in Syria. So the gospel's already spread north past Samaria and into parts of Syria. And it's set on the way to Damascus. So Morag is going to read today's passage for us. It's from Acts chapter 9, from verse 1 onwards.
Cool. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. "Now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do." The men traveling with Saul stood there speechless. They had heard the sound, but did not see anyone. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind and did not eat or drink anything. In Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, "Ananias." "Yes, Lord," he answered. The Lord told him, "Go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. In a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come to him and place his hands on him to restore his sight." "Lord," Ananias answered, "I have heard many reports about this man and all the harm he has done to your holy people in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priests to arrest all who call on your name." But the Lord said to Ananias, "Go. This man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name." Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, Brother Saul, the Lord, Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately, something like scales fell from Saul's eyes, and he could see again. He got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength.
Great. Thank you, Marek. So we're in this passage today. It's really a tale of two visions. We have a vision of Saul, but actually, interestingly, in the passage, Luke doesn't say he has a vision. He says he was blinded by a light and he heard a voice. But actually, when Saul becomes Paul, changes his name and writes to the early churches, he will describe this account as a vision. So we have his vision, and we have Ananias's vision. Both of them were reluctant. Saul, a reluctant convert. In fact, probably the exact opposite of what you expect to happen to Saul happens in this story. And Ananias, and perhaps understandably, is a reluctant minister. So Saul, what's his story? Well, as we've said already, he's incredibly zealous for God. He loves God and he loves the law, and he sees it as his duty to uphold that. And he sees the followers of the way, as Luke describes it in this particular passage, they're not called Christians yet, as basically disrupting that and leading people astray, actually. The problem with his zeal is that it's completely misplaced, isn't it? So if you think about other religious zealots in the world today, there are lots of them. And an obvious one when I was thinking about this passage is set in Damascus, which is in Syria. Well, we can think of some religious zealots that were only in this region not that long ago. And ISIS come to mind. 5 years ago, they came to this very city, Damascus, capturing people and killing people and torturing people who don't follow their idea of God. They think they're doing God's work, but actually, obviously, we know they're not, and including Christians. Saul thinks he's doing God's work by trying to stamp out this movement, and God actually has to bring him to his knees in order for him to see it. He's blinded by this great light, and he hears God's voice and falls to the ground. In a moment, his life is completely changed around. What about Ananias then? Well, he's one of the beneficiaries, isn't he, of this gospel movement moving. And he's a non-Jew who now has accepted God's grace, accepted through Jesus the beneficiary of what God always intended for non-Jews, which was for them to know their creator and for them to serve him and to live a life full of knowing him. And he's reluctant, and you can understand why, can't you? I mean, try and imagine it. I mean, even 5 years ago in Damascus, if you were a Christian and, you know, ISIS roll into town and they kill, burn down your church. Lots of churches and religious sites were burnt down. People you know, perhaps even people in your family, killed, horribly treated, brutally treated. And then he gets this message from God, this strong impression, this voice that tells him to get up and go to the very house of one of the people who's been doing who's been presiding over all this horrible stuff, who's been hurting people he knows, who've been burning down churches. I mean, you would be reluctant, wouldn't you? You'd be thinking, if I get this wrong, I'm dead. You're dead, aren't you? I mean, plus the fact that, you know, how much hurt and pain has this guy felt and the people that he knows? And God has told him to go and actually minister to the very person who's presiding over this persecution. It's quite a comical little exchange between Ananias and God. And it's not the first time that comedy has been used in Luke's gospel. In Luke's second gospel, Ananias reminds God, and I don't know if you've ever done this when you're praying, sometimes I do, where you actually speak into God as if he doesn't know what's going on already. I do that quite a lot, actually, like, God, well, this is happening, and God's like, yeah, I know that already. So Ananias is saying to God, reminding God that Saul's a really dangerous man. You know what he's come to Damascus to do? He's come to take people like me away and have us flogged and persecuted and possibly even stoned to death like Stephen. And God says, yeah, I know all that. I know everything. And God still tells him to go and do it. And interestingly, Ananias, in spite of his sort of initial reluctance, he actually does show incredible courage and bravery, doesn't he? He obeys God. And he must have had it must have been very strong, this idea of being able to hear God's voice, because, as I say, if he gets it wrong, he's in absolute turmoil, isn't he? So we've got a reluctant convert in Saul, we've got a reluctant minister in Ananias. What happens to both of them is that God meets them stops them in their tracks, and actually changes their life plans completely. God changes history through this little encounter. And what it reminds me of is it's something that Neil, if you've ever been in our church and heard Neil preach for over the years, he said this a few times, and it's just come back to me this time, was that when we become Christians, we don't enlist God on our cause. We don't say, right, I'm a Christian now. Right now, I've got my life is sort of supercharged by having God on my side. Not at all. God is the other way around. God enlists us onto his mission, doesn't he? He calls us and says, right, I've got a mission for you to share the good news of Jesus. I'm enlisting you onto my cause. You're not enlisting me onto yours. And this is kind of both of these guys prior to this encounter thought they were doing God's work, and God had to completely stop them in their tracks. Saul thought he was doing God's work by persecuting the church, and he had to die to that. He had to completely stop what he was doing. Ananias thought he had a responsibility to protect the church from people like Saul, and you can understand completely why. But God had to say, no, I don't need you to do that anymore. I want you to change. I want you to go into this house. So, and it just reminded me that when we decide to follow Jesus, we really need to submit to his authority and his plans for our lives, and not just say, well, yeah, I've got all my plans and now I've got God on my side. Well, actually, no, God might actually cause you to change your plans completely. And some of you might well know how that feels. So the question I had after this was about, obviously, last week we had Philip being sent by the Spirit and, you know, hearing God's voice. And this week we've got two visions, encounters. And the question, an obvious question, is does God still do this sort of thing? Does God still get people's attention in this sort of way, in dramatic ways? Does he still stop people in their tracks and change them 180? Well, the obvious answer to this is yes. I mean, not everybody's conversion is as dramatic as Paul's, is it? But nevertheless, you might actually recognize a similar pattern in your own conversion. So step one, God gradually, or maybe not gradually in this case, gets your attention. He stops you in your tracks. He causes you to have a time of reflection, to think about actually what's important in life and who am I and is there a God? And Saul's time of reflection was only 3 days, wasn't it? So he had 3 days where he didn't eat or drink anything. We're not sure why. Maybe it was just the shock of the vision. Maybe it was just this, my life has been heading in a completely different direction and I need time to just process it. Well, for you, it might have been 3 years. It could have been 30 years. You might have felt God's call over a longer period of time. And then he's ministered to by Ananias. He needs somebody else to come. It's interesting, isn't it? Why does God need Ananias to go around? Why can't God just sort him out without Ananias? And it's that amazing fact that God wants to use people like us to go and minister to other people. God could do it on his own, but he chooses people like you and me. And Ananias was one of those. And you will have been ministered to by other people, perhaps a few people over the time of your reflection and waiting to make a decision for Christ. And people that maybe either sort of confirmed truth to you, helped you to understand the Bible, or maybe just witnessed in that sort of, you know, natural way that Christians do. And then once you've made that, actually, you've had this moment of, now I see it. Now I see that God really is real. Jesus really did rise from the dead. You've got this moment of wanting to tell people, having a public declaration. And that's what baptism is, isn't it? All through the book of Acts, you see when people get changed, they want to show everybody else that their life has changed. They get baptized. Saul does it in this story. The Ethiopian unit did it straight away. His first response was, what's stopping me getting baptized? So I just encourage you today as well, if you've not been baptized, well, think about it, because that's a public declaration of what God's done in your life and doing in your life. So does God still do it? Actually, yes, he does it in much more understated ways, but he does still do it in dramatic ways. I've got a really good example of somebody I know. I was in a band with 20 years ago, and this guy had a vision or a dream that changed his life. And he was a man in his late 20s, intelligent, well-traveled, but incredibly fixed in his opinions of philosophies of life. He studied bits of philosophy and religion, and he'd come to the conclusion that it was all basically a load of rubbish. It was a load of way of controlling people, and, you know, all that sort of stuff causes wars and all that stuff. So he used to say all that sort of thing. So he was he's a really nice guy. I still spoke to him this week, but he was aggressively against religion. and very, very, you know, you couldn't tell him different. And we used to, when we'd have gigs, we'd sometimes stay around and have a drink, or we'd go back to someone's house. Sometimes we'd even go on to like a nightclub. And I remember one particular time when my wife Morag was having a discussion with him, a heated debate, as Mrs. Merton would say. And they were basically arguing almost in the street about God and whether God exists. And I remember him going, well, maybe when I get to like, you know, 70, 80 years old and I'm scared to death, then maybe, yeah, maybe then I will accept it. But it's just a lot of rubbish. When I'm scared, yeah, maybe. And I just remember this very vivid moment. We'd had lots of debates about God and faith and basically witnessing and being a good witness and arguing. No amount of doing that would make any difference to this guy. He was so fixed in his philosophy and in his ways of thinking that nothing was going to argue him otherwise. Anyway, a few years later, we finished with the band and I'd not really seen him very much. He rings me out of the blue and says, Ian, I just had a really, really, really weird night. I had a dream. And in the dream, I woke up and I was in a cold sweat and Jesus was on the cross. And God was saying to me, you need to accept Jesus. And I went back to sleep thinking this is just one of those weird dreams you have. But he had it again the same night. He had it a couple of times in a row. And he woke up absolutely, utterly convinced that God was getting his attention, that Jesus really did rise from the dead for him. And it was a complete and utter surprise to me, as it was to him. And it was amazing. And his whole thinking was changed in an instant after years of us trying to speak to him and to sort of argue and debate and show him in other ways. He wasn't having any of that, but God got his attention. And it just reminded me that God still does that sort of stuff. Maybe it's sometimes, I know most people say, well, if God shows me that he exists, then I'll believe. And well, actually, you know, that's not necessarily the way God always works, but God does do that. And he did it in my friend's life. And I was reminded again this week, he did it in, you know, he does it in some of the most hardened criminals that become completely and utterly changed by the love of Jesus. Shane Taylor, I've been reading his biography, an amazing account of a guy who was basically in prison for, he was in the maximum security prison. He was in the top six people in the UK of being the watch list, basically the most dangerous men in Britain. And he had an incredibly unexpected encounter through a humble minister doing an alpha course in the prison. Life completely changed around. And there's countless examples of that. So does God still do this sort of thing? Yes, he does. We might not all have this amazing vision experience or dream or audible voice, but God is still in the business of changing people's lives and changing them quite dramatically. Each of us needs to be ministered to, though. And I was just thinking, like, what can we learn from the story? Obviously, there's always loads of stuff you can apply in these stories, but just three things at least that we can sort of apply to our lives. So first thing is, nobody is beyond redemption. You know, it doesn't matter how hard their heart is. It doesn't matter how evil their life has been to this point. The scandal, the beautiful scandal of the gospel is that it doesn't matter how bad a person you are. We all come with completely clean slates when we come to Jesus. Jesus cleans the slate. Jesus is the one who takes the punishment we deserve. He's the one. Each one of us falls short. You might be a really good person. You might be a more moral person than a lot of Christians, but you still fall short of God's glory. But in this case, in Saul's case, he's a murdering terrorist and he didn't deserve God's grace any more than or any less than we do. But he wasn't beyond God's redemption. So we refuse to write people off, no matter how bad they are, no matter how far away you think they might be from God. Maybe you might be watching this today and think, actually, I've done some pretty bad things. Maybe not as bad as Saul. I'd be surprised if you'd done that. But you might be thinking, well, God's not going to accept someone like me because I've not been a great person. I'm not a particularly moral person. Well, the good news is that if he can change somebody like Saul, he can change somebody like you. And if he calls to people like Saul and changes his life, then he calls to you today. Secondly is that no act of obedience is wasted. Ananias, in spite of his initial reluctance, was obeyed God, didn't he? He did actually follow what God said. And so it just reminded me that no matter what God asks us to do, you know, we should obey. Now, he might not give us dramatic things like that where we have to sell up and become missionaries in China, although he might do that. Is he speaking to you today about that? Actually, he might just be calling you to be obeying the small things, continuing to have integrity at work, continuing to treat your husband or wife well, and treating you the way you treat your kids, the way you speak to people. So nothing is wasted, and God sees every act of obedience. And thirdly, that God can use each one of us to minister to other people. He used Ananias when he could have just done it on his own. And the good news is today that he still wants to use you as well. So we will serve whoever we meet. And the thing about being a Christian is that you can't just do this with people you like. You know, if it's friendship, you can choose for your friends, can't you? You can say, well, actually, I don't really like that person, so I'm not really going, I don't really have to talk to them. As a Christian, that's not really an option in many ways, because God calls you to speak to somebody. If you put somebody in your workplace that you don't really like, well, it's not an option. You're still the witness to that person. So you have to do that. And actually, he must have taken an incredible amount of grace and forgiveness from Ananias' part to do it to Saul. Can you imagine the hatred he must have had in his heart towards Saul, and knew that you would understand it? But he obeyed God and he served him. And it was through Ananias' obedience that Saul regained his sight. But more than that, he received the Holy Spirit. So some questions to ponder, at least three questions for reflection as I come to a close. First one is there anybody you've given up on? Maybe you've been praying for somebody for many years to become a Christian, or just to change in some way. Maybe they're already a Christian and they just need to change. And it's easy to give up when nothing seems to change. Saul would seem the most far away person from God, didn't he? But he did change 180 degrees. His life was changed around. In a moment, God could change that person's life. So just encourage you to keep praying, keep witnessing, keep being the light to that person. Is there anybody you've given up on or attempted to give up on? Who's God put in your way to minister to? What about at this particular moment? So it might be different at the moment during lockdown than it was 6 months ago when you were in, you know, when things were different. Maybe it's just your neighbor. Maybe your neighbor said to you, I'm going to a caravan and I want you to water my plants, as our neighbor does. Maybe it's somebody who's struggling for shopping, and actually you could be the one who ministers to them by getting them some shopping. It could just be sending somebody a message you haven't seen for a while. Who's God put in your path this moment? If you don't do that work, who else is going to do it? So who's God calling you to at this particular moment to minister to? And then finally, a big grand question really, which is, you know, not something you can answer straight away, but are you living for God's plans? Are you asking God what he wants of your life? Or actually, have you got into that trap of just basically doing whatever you want and asking God to bless it? It's really tempting, isn't it, for us to do that? So I'm just going to give some time, a couple of minutes, and ask Lorna to play while we do that. And if you might want to write those questions down, you might want it to just be you, between you and God, and you might want to just pray and think about it. But you may also want to put in the chat as well, while Lorna's playing about, and just in your response to these questions or anything else that's come up in the sermon. So we're going to give a few minutes without rushing on to the next bit of it for you to do that.
Consequences of doing something for God. But you know, God's got it. There was nothing that Ananias told God that God didn't already know. And there's nothing, no excuse we can give to God. If He has something for you to do, be courageous and bold. Take it up. Let's live God's plans, not for our own. It's been challenging me all week, that particular message about living for God's plan, not mine. It's just really a confirmation to me as Ian spoke those words that that's God speaking to me, challenging me. His grace is enough. It's enough for me, enough for you.
I will fall.
don't want to stop you coming in, Lord, where you want to come in. We want to submit to you, to your plan and your authority. We're going to be moving into a time of communion, sharing together in the thing that Jesus did for us by dying on that cross. And if you have some bread handy or a cracker or something that you can share with, and some juice or wine or whatever you've got to hand, we're going to share together. I just want to read a few words of scripture, so I'm just going to stop playing for a second because I can't do that and play. And so I'm going to read out from Colossians, and this is just again to raise our faith, to look to him. So it's Colossians 1 verse 15. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. That means you and I were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. We are reconciled to him. This word says, through him, he was to reconcile all things to himself. We are part of that reconciliation process. And as we share together in the body and eating the bread and drinking the wine or the juice, we're remembering what Jesus did for us in that reconciliation, in bringing us back into relationship with his Father. And the next bit just says, and you who once were estranged and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and irreproachable before him, provided that you continue in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel which you heard, which has been preached to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, became a minister. These are the words of Paul, the same guy that had been beating up the church, that had been wreaking all kinds of havoc in the early church, and yet God reached him with his word, reached him through Ananias. And you and I can be part of that plan. Let's share together in the bread and the wine. So I'm just going to play again gently whilst you sort of do that bit. So we take his bread, which is the body of Jesus. We remember what he did for us on that cross. He broke the power of sin in our lives. We don't have to give way to it anymore. He gives us the power to overcome. And then we take the wine or the juice and we drink together, representing Jesus's blood poured out for the forgiveness of our sins, for those evil things that the Bible was just talking about there that we were doing before. And he pours his blood out over us and washes us clean, white as snow. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Just while Alana continues to play, just a couple of people responded in the chat. Jill says, I feel like God is speaking to me about battles and fighting. God reminded me of the verse that says that our enemies aren't people. I think he's saying to some of us this morning that we need to stop fighting the relationships and the people he's placed around us. I also feel that he's saying that success and failure are of no difference to him. He can use both. Someone needs to hear this morning that you've been made and ready for battle. The weapons are already in your hands, but choose the weapons God gives and not the weapons that scar and harm. God wants people to see your battles and praise him. And Emmanuel and Jumi said, question 3, about living for God's plans and not our own. Reflection equates to living my best life, which is living my Christ life. Yeah, we're not preaching a gospel of you can just be you, but better. We're actually saying your best life is when you're actually living in God's plans. That's what you were created for. Your best life is living in Christ's life and living by his Spirit. Thank you for those reflections. So back to Lorna for our last song.
Yeah, thank you, Ian. This song is all about Jesus, the fact that he is the strong one. He's the one that broke our sin. And through him, he gives us the strength to serve him. Thank you that you are Lord of all. You are higher, as we sang at the beginning. You are stronger. And that you can fill our lives with the resurrected power that is the same power that rose you from the dead, that overcame sin and death. We praise you that that same power lives in each one of us. And we ask you, Lord, that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit to live and work for you this week. Amen.